because of this, it shows the greatness of his love. And so, kind of pick up two verses. The first one's Proverbs 16:6. By steadfast love and faithfulness, iniquity is atoned for. And by the fear of the Lord, one must turn away from evil. The faithfulness, I learned this from Nathaniel. He has some really awesome notes on this. The faithfulness is equivalent to justness. God's faithfulness to his moral character. God's faithfulness to his goodness. So by steadfast love and his justness, iniquity, our sin, was atoned for. And by the fear of the Lord, one turns away from evil. In Psalm 85:10, it says, steadfast love and faithfulness meet righteousness and peace kiss each other. That's in Psalm 85:10. So there is no conflict between God's love and his justice. Kind of back to what I talked about in that movie, Dead Man Walking. He had a hard time confronting reality of sin. I have a hard time confronting the reality of my sin. But we only understand God's love only so far as we understand his justice. Or a better way to say it probably is that we don't understand the gravity of his grace unless we understand the gravity of our sin. That's why Paul opens up in chapters 1 through 2, because the good news is the good news unless we understand the bad news, right? Kind of put it as an analogy. It's a little intricate, and yes, it might be cheesy. But imagine a man who has a disease, okay? And he doesn't know about it. And he won't know about it until the symptoms arise. By the time the symptoms arise, it's too late. And so if he's got this hidden disease, is he going to go to a doctor? Is he going to feel the need to go see a doctor? No. To him, his condition is fine, perfectly fine. There's nothing wrong with him. He's okay, so why do we need to go and see after a doctor? And let's even say that this disease he has even has a cure, but the doctor can fix it. If he just goes to the doctor, he can fix it. But the man will not go, right? I mean, if I was okay, I'm not going to go see a doctor right now. Like, I feel great, you know. I mean, I might go for my checkup or something, but there's no need in my mind to go fix this kind of disease because in my mind I don't have it, right? Let's say one day he does go on a checkup or something and he realizes that he does have this disease. He's probably going to go see a doctor. He's probably going to seek after a doctor. And the cure that he once heard about is now something very precious to him because it's going to save his life. But unless he confronted the reality of his disease, unless he went to go see the doctor, he's not going to get it fixed. And it's the same thing with our sin issue, is that if we don't confront the reality of it, we don't really embrace the fact that we are under God's wrath. In our minds, then, we don't need Jesus' grace, right? We don't accept that. And that's what it means to really understand God's love, because God's love is understood in a way to say this. How much we recognize God's grace is proportionately related to how much we recognize our own sin. One time I was teaching this to a church I used to go to, and I put it like, this is God, and this is us, or me. I used to like music singing, but I'm not going to do that right now. So, this is God, God's holiness, righteousness, and this is me down here, right? I'm not holy, I'm not righteous. I'm under God's wrath. And every time we try to deny our sin, like Matthew Postle did in Dead Man Walking, we're saying we're not as bad as we think we are until we're level with God. And now the question is there any grace there? Is there any, do we recognize God's love when we're up here? We don't. Because we haven't fully admitted to ourselves the reality of our sin. You understand someone's love in proportion to how much you recognize when you do something wrong and they love you. You know, like if, for instance, Andy has a really cool bike, and say, like, he says something like, oh, like, Brian makes better coffee than you or something. And I get upset. And I go take his bike and I go to the top of McNutt and I like throw it off. It's not the ground. Okay, yeah, that's higher up, yeah. So I go do that, right? And Andy like completely forgives me right? That's the way he has his Pokemon names. So like, he forgives me. Let's say he buys me a bike and he treats me. He buys me all the coffee in the world or something. And I'm like, oh. Like, when I fully admit, like, wow, what I did was really mean, you know? Like, I shouldn't have thrown his bike off the building. Like, I begin to understand how much Andy really loves and cares for me when he does that. That's only if I recognize, like, what I did was really bad, right? Like, that I didn't deserve that, he didn't deserve that, that I should have done that. And it's the same with the relationship with God. We say, oh, I'm just as good as God. Why do we need the gospel? Why are we reading the Bible then if I can obtain righteousness on my own? Defeats the whole purpose of Paul's argument. It means Jesus has died in vain because we're saying, no, I'm better than you. And Matthew Constant in that movie was a very wonderful performance because John Penn did a great job of, like, he was in so much pain. Like, you could just tell he could not admit that he had raped and murdered this young couple. He just couldn't admit it. He was so afraid of the consequences. He was a slave of fear because he figured, if I admit to Jesus, if I admit to God that this is what I did, it's over. I admit that I deserve his wrath, and that's it. And so he denied it, until he finally confronted with himself. Jesus' grace was there for him. I think we have a hard time admitting that for ourselves. I have a hard time admitting that. I'm really not as good as I thought I was. That's why God loves us. That's his power and his justice. His love and his justice that collides together. And every time we deny it, we say no, but what we're really saying is, I can fix this. I can fix this before it's too late. Like, I can do it. That's like trying to take a Tylenol and you get, like, a demonic plague, right? It doesn't work out. So, one of the things I recognize, and for some application, I'm going to talk a little bit about this. And in my own experience, sometimes I read the Bible and I come across some passages that are very convicting. That are like, wow. I didn't recognize the depth of my depravity without Jesus Christ. And I mean, it's just point blank. God never takes us there so he can drop us and say, there you go, Romans 1 through 2, but he doesn't do that. He brings us to chapter 3, but that's like the biggest contraction you will ever hear in your entire life. Like, that's the turning point of this book. But we need to admit that to ourselves. We need that we're going to see the love of God more than we could ever imagine. Because now we see, just like if I threw Andy's bike off the road, how much he really loves me when he decides to take the payment, when he decides to instead show me grace and love. That's only in proportion to if I recognize my sin. The ratification, maybe you guys are believers in Jesus Christ, maybe you are not. The non-believers, if you aren't, have you admitted to yourself the reality of your sin? Do you believe in the grace? Do you believe that God's work really secured your righteousness? If you believe and put your faith and trust in him? It is a death to oneself to admit that you deserve God's wrath. But Jesus resurrects us back and shows that his grace is real and that he really loves us. For the believer, maybe you're confronting, you have some sin in your life. Maybe your identity is in your college, maybe the things you look at night are not right. Maybe you're having a hard time accepting the fact that you have that sin. But there's grace. You can admit and confess to Jesus Christ. That's the beauty of it. You see his love so much more clearly. You can bring it to him and say, God, I'm sorry for what I've done. You no longer trust in trying to fix the issue, but you have fully given yourself to the work of Jesus Christ. And it changes you. And you know, this is just a little bit, like, this is just the introductory. Like, the rest of this year is going to unpack the beauty of this message and the inheritance we have in Jesus Christ. And I encourage you guys to stick around and listen to it. And that's all I have, and I just want to close out in words of prayer. But if there's any of you that are struggling with your sin, whether you're a believer or not a believer, there's staff, there's officers, talk to them. And they'll help you, they'll talk with you. Lord, I just want to thank you for your grace and the power of your love. I ask that you would help us to really put our faith and trust in you when we recognize that what we are and what we've done, it has deserved your wrath, God, but that the grace of your Son, Jesus Christ, dying for us, being crucified and being resurrected on the third day, was not so that we can be condemned, to be guilty, but to be truly saved. I ask that if there's anybody in here who are struggling with that, I know we all, in some degree, one or another, are struggling with that. I ask that you would open our eyes to the grace that is in you. I ask that you would help us to see that we no longer have to be slaves of fear, but Lord, that we can be perfected in your love. And I pray this in your precious Son's name, Jesus Christ, Lord. Amen.